I want to introduce our first presenter. Jason Matrokin was born in Anchorage, Alaska. He earned his bachelor's degree in business administration from Massachusetts College of Liberal Arts and his MBA from Alaska Pacific University. After serving for 5 years on the board of directors and as director of shareholder and corporate relations for Bristol Bay Native Corporation, he was named as president and chief executive officer in January of 2009. Jason is what we call an afterborn. I don't like that word. Who wrote that? And is a part of a new generation of Alaska Native leaders at our Alaska Native Corporations. Jason.
Thank you, Sherry. I've been called a lot worse, actually, so I don't mind after all these years. I really want to thank the university, Chancellor Case, Provost Gingrich, who I met for the first time today, Dean Prasad, of course, Professor Lind. I also want to recognize my elders. Having to speak after Byron and Willie is no small task. You notice they didn't have a single note in their hand? It's pretty amazing. They asked us to talk today about innovations and investing in Alaska. And I know I have a PowerPoint presentation. If I could get that launched up. I know some of the folks in the room might not be able to see the presentation. It's not super complicated. I know at least many of the people on this side of the room who I recognize are very familiar with the ANCSA model, the one at the bottom. UAA. And so while it's not overly complicated, I think you can follow along and I'll certainly speak to it as we go. And I think there's going to be copies available through, through the media team here, so you're welcome to it when I'm done. But just to give some context, really, in talking about Bristol Bay Native Corporation, where I've been working since 2003, in fact, thinking of the innovation and defining innovation, it's different to all of us. In some ways, my middle name could be innovation. I came to Bristol Bay Native Corporation in 2003, kind of in a backwards approach to BBNC, first starting on the board of directors, then becoming a member of the management team, and now as a president and CEO. It's not really your typical path to the executive office with any corporation. And really what it says is I've painted myself into a very lonely corner. I have no social life. I spend all my time working, and any ounce of extra time I get, it's with my family. So. It's been an interesting ride thus far. BBNC represents today roughly 10,000 shareholders of about 5,400 were our original enrollees. Of course, many of them have since passed on. And we're all working towards enriching our native way of life. That's BBNC's mission statement in a nutshell, enriching our native way of life. And we've strived over these many years now, 40 plus years, BBNC was incorporated in June of 1972. Really to talk about ways and promote ways to enrich our native way of life. It's different for every person. I grew up here in Anchorage. I'm an urban native, an afterborn, not an original enrollee. And of course, many of our shareholders living in their home villages in Bristol Bay or in faraway places like New Hampshire or the Dominican Republic, Norway, Australia. In today's society, we have our shareholders spread out all over the world. But BBNC has really, really spent a lot of time focusing on our strategic plan. And this plan itself has been in place for over 10 years. Really since my time working with the corporation, we have been very focused on our long-term strategic goals. And they all really intertwine. BBNC focuses on our financial goals, building the value of the company's assets, increasing its financial strength and its profitability into the future. So that we can pay predictable and increasing dividends to our shareholders. When we do shareholder surveys, which we do pretty regularly, our shareholders say that dividends are the utmost important, most important benefit that the corporation provides. It's not the only benefit, but it's the most important benefit. And we do that in a predictable fashion. We promote employment opportunities and educational opportunities for our shareholders. We position ourselves, or we strive to position ourselves, as a major voice in economic development in our region. And we have most recently endorsed a fish first policy, meaning that everything we do when it comes to investing or business within BBNC, we want to ensure that it's not going to be of detriment to the local Bristol Bay fishery. In fact, we strive to create benefits to our local fishery. going through just a little bit of financial history for BB&C before I get into the topic of innovation and what we're trying to do more so here in the state of Alaska. This is just a snapshot over the last 10 or so years of the gross revenue experience for BB&C, and what you can see is we've been on a pretty steep curve from a revenue standpoint. It wasn't too long ago that BB&C finally bumped up against or surpassed the $1 billion mark in revenues, which I know many of our counterpart corporations have done the same. Congratulations on that achievement. And you can see in most recent years, we've even bumped up towards a $2 billion revenue goal, which really revenues at the end of the day are great. We're proud of them, but they're not the end-all be-all for the corporate model for BB&C. And from an earnings standpoint, and this graph shows both pre-tax and after-tax earnings for BB&C, you'll notice that in sort of the earlier years of this 10-year slide history, it was pretty volatile. BB&C was very focused on marketable securities in our investment portfolio and a sort of the tail wagging the dog scenario. But in more recent years, in the last 5 years specifically, we've reached historic earnings marks for BB&C, both again pre-tax and after-tax. And it's been focusing on this strategic plan and our financial future, even in some fairly difficult financial times, that BB&C has really been able to make some strong strides and some posting some stable earnings for the corporation, allowing us to live up to those strategies that I talked about earlier. Shareholder equity, of course, is important for all of our corporations. BB&C's experience, again, in recent years, the last 10 years, has been very strong. By policy, 35% of our earnings go out in the form of shareholder dividends, and then 65% of those earnings are retained. And I'm very proud of that, those achievements. Our dividends, since 1978, BB&C has paid a predictable and increasing dividend. That very first dividend payment was 25 cents a share annually. And you can see how that has grown, even in this current year, we're in fiscal year 2016, which is not on the graph. BB&C is paying $32.40 per share. And again, we're proud of this achievement because, again, it's been on a pretty, a positive curve. But it's now starting to mean something to our shareholders. And we pay a dividend in the neighborhood of $30+ per share. We make those payments in quarterly installments, but now we're talking about real money. In fact, we've surpassed the Alaska Permanent Fund, which our board members are pretty proud of, and I know our shareholders are as well. But in order to continue to achieve this type of dividend distribution, BB&C has to have a really strong financial strategy. Just a very basic slide talking about asset allocation, which has been a major component of BB&C's strategic plan for many years. Very simply stated, 65% of our assets are dedicated to our operating businesses. BB&C has a number of different operating businesses doing business in currently all but 4 U.S. states and 11 foreign countries, but it's a very robust piece of our business and one that we have much more control over than, say, the marketable securities, of which 25% of our assets are dedicated to an investment portfolio. And then rounding out the rest, 10% dedicated to corporate assets, and probably the easiest and greatest example of that is our corporate building that Sherry mentioned many of us have here in Anchorage. And moving along, we have, as I mentioned, a number of subsidiary companies, more than you can even see on this slide, but it's really broken down into 5 strategic sectors within our operating company mix. Industrial services, which are by and large oil and gas service companies. Construction services and government services. Those 2 sectors are by and large doing government contracting with the Department of Defense and other agencies of the federal government. We've got petroleum distribution, mainly down in the Pacific Northwest, but we've had a recent acquisition out in Bristol Bay. And then we have tourism, which is probably our newest addition to our business mix. So getting to the point of the presentation, really, and what I think many of us were here to talk about today is what's driving BB&C to be innovative, especially when it comes to doing business here in Alaska. On the previous slide, you saw a lot of different sectors. BB&C has done business around the world, and particularly in the lower 48, really since we started business. We owned Peter Pan Seafoods at one point in time. We had a lot of different business holdings in other parts of the United States or other parts of the world. But our board said in roughly 2011, we're not doing enough here at home. We're not investing enough in Alaska, and we're not investing enough in Bristol Bay. It's been some years since we really had a presence in our own region, and of course, all the benefits that type of investment provides. So Our management team, along with the input and direction from our board, came up with what we call an in-region investment strategy. And what we said is we were going to take a portion or a percentage of our operating asset allocation and direct it towards investments in Bristol Bay. So what that means is in rough dollars, $35 million was going to be dedicated to investing in Bristol Bay. And in roughly 2011, we made that commitment. We were going to apply our expertise that we've learned over the years to those investments in the region. And we were going to have a return expectation. I think what's been challenging for many of us who've tried to do business in our own home communities or in Village, Alaska, it's challenging to get a return on your investment in smaller communities where, let's just say, diversification is not thriving in many of our regions or many of our communities. They tend to be sort of one particular sector focused. And those returns could be calculated in both a financial sense and a non-financial sense. And I'll talk a little bit more about that. And even though BB&C is a growing company, we have our own internal expertise. There are many, many external consultants and advisors and experts that we've utilized to help us to live out this commitment. As I mentioned, the financial and non-financial returns, BB&C has a return expectation. If you look at the whole enterprise of BB&C investments, whether they're in operating companies and marketable securities or otherwise, we've experienced a 16% return on our equity investments in our recent history. And so when we talk about investing in the Bristol Bay region, what we told our board is that we need to have that same financial return expectation. It might be hard, but we think we can achieve that. We have to be innovative. We have to be creative. And in addition to that, by providing these types of investment opportunities, there are the non-financial benefits to our region. Jobs, additional training opportunities, as well as continued economic diversification. Of course, in our region, it's all about fish. Socially, economically, environmentally, it's all about fish. But it can't be just fish. It needs to be additional sectors or additional diversification in order to have a healthy environment, or a healthy economy in Bristol Bay. So, going back to those sectors of business I talked about, we were already invested in tourism, fuels, government contracting, natural resource development being another area we're invested in, and of course, private equity or our experience with marketable securities. BB&C, on one hand, needed to think outside the box by investing in our own region, but why steer away from what we've come to know? And all of these different experiences and all these different subsidiary companies we have, we've learned some things. We want to apply that to investing in Bristol Bay as well. So we took each one of those sub-allocation areas, if you will, in tourism, government contracting, natural resource development, marketable securities, or what we're calling private equity, and regional fueling, and we said we're going to allocate certain dollars to each one of these sectors as targets so that we can go out and start shopping, if you will, for new investment opportunities, but do it in a fairly strategic or targeted way. And so far, that's proven to work out for us. I'm not going to talk about each one of these sectors. There's actually a few success stories that I could talk about, but because of the time availability, I just wanted to really highlight a fairly recent success story for BB&C, and that's what we believe could be proven wrong, but we believe is the first and only Alaska Native owned and managed private equity fund. And this fund was launched in October of last year, so it's really only a year old. And it's called the Bristol Bay Development Fund. The fund is intended to have a more active presence for BB&C in our home region. I was talking earlier this afternoon with someone where shareholders, community members were coming to us and saying, hey, we've got a business idea. And we have lots of entrepreneurs in Bristol Bay. This is a commercial fishing industry or commercial fishing region like other regions of the state. And every commercial fisherman is what? A small business owner. They own their own business. So a lot of entrepreneurialism in Bristol Bay, but people were coming to us with business ideas where they needed $20,000 or $50,000 or $100,000. And fortunately or unfortunately, at least in BB&C's experience, those are the types of deals that we don't really touch anymore. And I think some of our regional counterparts even might have policies where they say, no deal under $10 million is of our sort of standard, if you will. And so BB&C had a really difficult time working with our shareholders on what we would consider to be small or very small business opportunities. So we just weren't having those conversations. But we set up this fund with a $5 million total fund amount, and we took one of our managers, shareholder, Cameron Poindexter, and we matched him up with a local private equity advisor, and we launched this development fund last year. It's meant to be more hands-on for Bristol Bay. It's meant to be regionally focused. And ultimately, if done successfully, it can create a pipeline for deals that could come BBNC's way that have already been in their own right successful. The mission of the fund is to be a catalyst for in-region startup survival, success, and growth through effective deployment of financial and non-financial capital. The goals of the fund are really to facilitate the success of startup businesses or existing businesses that are looking to grow in the Bristol Bay region, and to create opportunities that have benefits for BBNC shareholders. Supporting the local economy out in the region, ultimately deploying $5 million within a 4-year span with an 11-year total life, or a 7-year harvest period, if you will. Opportunities for the private equity investment model and improving the credibility of BBNC ultimately as a business partner. Again, we weren't really having conversations with folks out in the region who had great ideas ultimately, but quite potentially too small for BBNC. The criteria for this fund is it can be any business in the region or a business that ultimately benefits the region. The investment sizes are $20,000 to $500,000. There are various investment stages from seed to growth. Ultimately, we're looking to find an exit strategy, which is important for the fund, potentially to have a second version of the fund in the future. But again, trying to create a metric for a return for BBNC and for the fund ultimately. And the investment fund must have the real potential to provide a return to BBNC. Much like the experiences the corporation has had, we know that there's all types of different sectors in Bristol Bay that maybe we haven't had an experience in that the fund could capture in terms of new business opportunities that might be fishery related, they could be energy or transportation, agriculture and food securities, something of as of late that's been talked about a lot in rural Alaska, technology, and then health and wellness. So far, again, in the first year of the fund, we've technically had 3 investments to date. 2 in a business called Adesco LLC. It's shareholder owned. It started in 2005. It's mainly a marine transportation and fish tendering contractor. And they've been able to purchase and upgrade a 74-foot landing craft to help grow their business. A third investment really was made in Viking Constructors, not a shareholder owned, but a regionally focused, based out of Igigik, Alaska, contractor that started in 2009. Again, very similar to Adesco, it's also a fish tendering and marine transportation business. And the investment that we helped with enabled the purchase and installation of tendering equipment and some additional operating capital. So while the first 2 success stories, if you will, happen to be in similar business or similar sectors, really we're looking for lots of different opportunities. And I believe the pipeline today, while many of the deals that come in or walk in the door are sort of at their infancy stage, ideas, trying to put them down on paper, creating budgets and forecasts, the idea is that we have quite a pipeline of new ideas that ultimately need to get to an investable stage, but utilizing the resources of the university system, utilizing the resources of the plethora of consultants that exist here in the urban markets, and trying to get those folks to relate more or even get out to parts of rural Alaska will really help this fund grow. So what does this mean for BBNC? In addition to this newly created Bristol Bay Development Fund, our total in-region investment strategy since 2011 has already deployed $20 million in Bristol Bay, in tourism, in regional fuels, in natural resource development, as well as the development fund. And again, our enterprise-wide, and what I mean by that is all of BBNC's investments and operations combined, we still are meeting and or exceeding our 16% return on equity return expectation, including investing through innovative ideas like the development fund. This is new, it's early stage, it'll be a period of time, roughly 7 years after all the funds have been deployed, that we that we harvest those returns, but it's intended to supplement our 16% return expectations. If it does not, that means that our investments elsewhere have to exceed the 16% return expectation for us to have that weighted average return. But by focusing on in-region investments, it's resulted in some additional benefits. Our shareholder hired has tripled in the last 4 years, as has our shareholder wages. And in addition to the funds that the Bristol Bay Development Fund is putting out the door, and again, it's early stage, we've already been able to leverage additional dollars, whether they're state-funded programs, federally funded programs, the private sector, or even the philanthropic dollars that are out there and available. We're now leveraging those dollars even more so out into our region. And anyone who's lived or spent any time in rural Alaska, every dollar that goes into that community is going to be passed around several times before that dollar exits the community. So all of these concentrated leveraged dollars in rural Alaska really go much further, we believe, than they do in some of the urban parts of our state. So that's it in a nutshell. I want to say thank you. Again, a couple of other additional opportunities or additional investments that BBNC has experienced. I'd be happy to talk about those at another time. But in a nutshell, we're very excited to be thinking about and actually creating some innovative investment opportunities in our region. And again, I appreciate the invitation today, and I don't know if we're doing questions now or at the end. So.
Yeah, and so we're going to take a break after Jason. There's cookies and coffee that Sharon put together, but we wanted to offer the first questions to the students of Sharon first. So if you want to A, no. if you have questions of Jason, later on in the summit, what we want to think about is what policy changes are needed to improve the Alaska Native Corporation's ability to stimulate the Alaska economy. So keep that in mind also as we're moving forward. And I don't know if Jason, you've thought about that at all, but I know that the AFN is thinking about it and the whole state is looking at ways to stimulate our economy. But with that, do we have any questions from the students that are here? No. We have a microphone. We'll travel.
I was supposed to use that, wasn't I?
Oh, you did. You can hear really good in here. Yeah. Yeah. Okay.
Do we have other questions?
Other questions from other people? Over here? Dorothy? And if you could just introduce yourself.
Dorothy Shockley from Manly Hot Springs.
It's on, but
not
you
for
just.
Me.
Thank
yeah.
You.
Just talk about it.
Okay. Dorothy Shockley. I'm curious as to how you work with your village corporations, or if you do, and if so, how?
That's a great question, Dorothy. When we began, just a quick story at least, when we began our sort of $35 million commitment to in-region investing, sort of naively, we expected there to be this onslaught of requests, ideas, proposals, et cetera, crickets for 2+ years, it was just silence. And what we recognize is that, like it or not, in many parts of urban America, people have become so used to grant dollars and the utilization of government funding to support ideas, programs, projects, investments, et cetera. It's no different in Bristol Bay. And so we really were forced, fortunately, to think differently about investing with a return expectation. And so it's become really apparent that we have to get out and educate folks, talk about what it means to invest capital with a return expectation. And it takes time. And so we've done a lot of outreach with our village corporations. We've done a lot of outreach with tribes, cities, boroughs, you know, individual entrepreneurs, et cetera. And in our case, we have a 30+ year ongoing event in December. So coming up soon, where we invite all of our village leaders from Bristol Bay into Anchorage, and we hold a Bristol Bay Leadership Forum. And it's an opportunity for community leaders, whatever hat they have on, to come in and interact with BBNC and to talk about new investment opportunities or to propose new investment opportunities. And it's really been a great venue for educating as well as talking about new business ideas that BBNC could ultimately now, especially with the development fund, take a look at investing in. So Hope that answers your question.
Thank you, Jason. Yeah. Is there a question here? Can you just stand speak loudly, introduce
Cynthia
yourself?
Izon, I'm a student here. I'm also in the entrepreneurial class. And do you come into the college to see if maybe there's opportunities here in working with some of the students and their ideas?
Sure. I've been invited multiple times from Sharon to come and speak to her class, and I think I'm doing that again relatively soon. But have we come into the college to sort of hear pitches or ideas? Not yet. I think that's a great suggestion.
We have a professor here who's with the entrepreneurial class.
Great.
That teaches, and he's actually working with us and helping us develop ideas.
That sounds like a fantastic opportunity. And I know Cameron Poindexter, our development fund manager, has interacted with the university, as well as APU and some of the other programs around the community. So I would say if the door is open to invitation, we'd love to have Cameron come and hear some of those ideas.
I have another question in the back. Could you stand up and
I'm also a student here, and my question was there any natural development resources that have been developed from the investments that you have been ongoing to
find? Specifically natural resource development opportunities? In our region, we have, in addition to fish, we have a tremendous amount of gravel. And BB&C has been in the gravel business ever since we started in 1972. And if it's fisheries related, and we have the CDQ program in many parts of Western Alaska, Bristol Bay Economic Development Corporation focuses almost entirely on the Bristol Bay fishery and the investments around the Bristol Bay fishery. It's not to say that BB&C couldn't or shouldn't invest in fisheries, but we really tend to take the lead of BBEDC. But there's been conversations more recently about joint investments between BB&C and BBEDC in the fisheries. And when it comes to natural resource development, of course, there's a very large project in our region that a lot of people like to debate about. And while BB&C doesn't support that particular project, there may be all kinds of responsible natural resource development projects in our region, whether they're sand, rock, and gravel, responsible mineral projects, oil and gas, or alternative energy. We're open to sort of any and all of that. So again, early stage. In fact, I was talking with our land department today that we really need to get out and promote more responsible natural resource development projects in our region, again, to round out that economic diversification, because the opportunity's there.
Thanks, Jason. We're going to take one more question before we take a break.
Yeah. Hi, I'm Michael Shestakoff. I'm with TDX Fuels. I have a very practical question, I guess. So with all these opportunities for new projects, mm-hmm. there might be hundreds and thousands of them, from $1,000 to millions of dollars, what's mechanics? What's the structure you have to filter all this stream of ideas and plans and stuff? You have to review and you have to determine good or not good or what? How's it practically done?
It's very archaic. We have a small team of employees at BB&C, 42 to be exact, in our corporate office. And we have a small, what we call a management investment committee. And anytime a deal comes through the door, whether it's through the development fund or any other path, we try to sit down and look at any and all deals that might make sense for
there's
us.
There's no like gate for the idea, so everybody can come and submit it here, and then it goes through the stream.
No, to be specific, but then again, we don't have a line of people outside our door either. So we have the
maybe because of that.
We have the good fortune of being able to really look at any deal again that makes sense for us. We have a specific commitment to investing in our region. But at the same time, we have investments all over the world. So we get a lot of pitches, we get a lot of phone calls, we get a lot of proposals, and we work to sift through those. And if a deal makes sense to us or has merit, we look at it, we analyze it, we bring it to our internal investment committee. And if it's something that we support, we bring it to our board.
Thank you. Yeah.
So very good. Thank you, Jason. Sure. So
as we return to our seats, and we're very glad to have time to have each of you connect with each other, we want to move on with our program, and we have two more speakers, two more models, organizational models being presented. Based on Jason Matrokin's presentation, I started to hear many people have thoughts, the wheels are turning, they're thinking about entrepreneurship, venture funding, roles for government, roles for the university, and we can start to visualize many of these. So let's move on to the next presenter. I'd like to also point out, though, that our next presenter, who's luckily she's right there, Maver Carey. I didn't want to turn to our next presenter and the seat be vacant there. But Jason and Maver have been very generous with their time. They've really contributed to our Alaska Native Business Management Program by, you know, the generosity with their time, with coming, talking to classes, and especially mentoring students. It's really a wonderful thing to have intergenerational mentoring, the new generation of leaders in our state being mentored by the current generation. So I want to express a note of gratitude, a note of thanks for that. So our next presenter, Maver Carey, who is a shareholder at the Kuskokwim Corporation, has been with the company for 21 years. And she served in a variety of positions, worked her way up through the corporation, and is now the president and CEO. She became president and CEO in 2003. Ms. Carey is responsible for the supervision and control of business affairs of the corporation. Maver, like Jason, is a shareholder who worked her way up the corporation, and we're very pleased to have her share her story of success. Maver, please.
Okay, I need this, so it better work, right? Okay, I'm not as loud as those gentlemen over there. Gentlemen. I have a story about Willie Hensley, but he's not here. So he stepped out. We'll tell it when he's here, because it embarrasses him and me. So I am the president and CEO of the Kuskokwim Corporation. I started out as the receptionist. I was working at in the marketing department for an engineering company, fresh out of college. I wasn't 10, Carl. I was a little older. And they laid everybody off. 50 people got laid off. Marketing department was the first to go. And I was the last person hired. I went knocking on my Native Corporation door and said, do you have anything at all? I'll take anything. And they gave me a $9 an hour job as the receptionist while I looked for my real job. This is the only job I've had out of college. So I've grown in every single department, and I've been there forever. It's my whole life. It's all that I know how to do. So if I got fired, I wouldn't know what to do. Okay, which one is it? Okay, so it's the middle one. Oh, bottom one. Okay, so these are our villages. 10 of our villages actually merged together after ANCSA. They were all their individual village corporations from Upper and Lower Kalskeg all the way up to Stony River. If we have enough time, I'm going to tell you a story about Upper Kalskeg. I have two examples of innovative ways on moving forward with ideas. And if we have enough time, I'm going to tell you a story about this bottle that you see right here at the end of my presentation. So we own 1 million acres of land, and Andrea is our land manager and communications. We've been to all 10 villages at least 3 times in the last 3 months. So I'm either out there or I'm traveling to one of our subsidiaries, which I'll show you in a minute. We own the surface estate of the land, and Chilista is the regional corporation. They own the subsurface. In a minute, I'm going to talk to you about Donlin Creek, which is potentially the largest gold mine in the world, and it's sitting on our surface lands. So I'll get to that in a minute. We are within the Chilista region, and you've heard from Jason. He's one of the regional corporations in the Chilista region, which is yellow. There are 56 individual village corporations, and we're one of those villages within that region. When I became CEO in 2004, we had none of these subsidiaries. We had a stock and bond portfolio of $9 million, and we had about 4 real estate investments that we did not manage. Our revenue was $1.2 million. Keeps cutting off there. $1.2 million, and our net income was about $175,000. Last year, our revenue was $78 million, and at one point, we were at $150 million in revenue after creating all of these subsidiaries. We've been very diversified. Okay. So we've been very diversified in creating these companies with Donlin Creek and its potential of becoming the largest gold mine in the world. We just negotiated a surface use agreement. Calista Corporation obviously owns the gold resources. It's a gold mine. And as a landowner, the surface owner, it's very typical for landowners to only get land financial benefits. We were able to negotiate contracts. So you can see from the portfolio there, this is going to double in size if Donlin does become a gold mine. They're in the permitting stage, and Donlin could potentially start construction in 2016. One of the main contracts that we got is building, operating, and maintaining the port site. And again, that's very unusual for a village corporation to get those contracts. Another contract we got, which if the mine goes through is going to be a 30-year mine life, is the reclamation of the land. Who better to reclaim the land than the people that own it and live on the land? Okay. We started enrolling our descendants. We don't call them afterborns. We call them descendants. I call them children, but I've got three board members who are now children on my board of directors. My vice chairman of the board is the youngest one, and so I definitely do not call her a child anymore. She's my boss. So we have tripled in size, and we started out with 1,100 shareholders. We have the same expectation to provide dividends to our shareholders, and throughout the years we have. When I first started as CEO, our dividend was about $150 to each shareholder, but we had less shareholders. Now our dividend is about $365. If we hadn't enrolled these descendants, it would have been about $1,100. So as we're growing in size, we know that we have to keep up with Joneses and keep the financial benefits coming, because we're going to reach 5,000 shareholders by the year 2020. So we've got to keep that revenue source coming in. This is a picture of one of our villages. Our villages are the poorest in the state of Alaska. This is Tuathbalak. I was unfortunately just there about a week ago for a funeral. I've got three relatives who are buried there, and two of them by suicide, which is a very unfortunate thing that happens to our younger generation and a lot of our men within our region. So unfortunately, I was there for another death like that. This is a picture of our shareholders, and my favorite one is our elder that's in the middle. She just passed away, though, a couple of years ago, and I miss her very much. Okay, so I didn't have enough to do when I was CEO. I was actually 8.5 months pregnant when they said, "You're ready to be the CEO." And I said no about 5 times. And they said, "Yes, you are." And so I took the job. And then about 3 years ago, as a new CEO, my background, those of you who are in school, take those math classes. Because I graduated with a public relations degree, so I could avoid the math classes. And I sure could have used them. So I've had lots of on-the-job training. Take the math. Just do it, even if you hate it. I hate it. Do it. Trust me. So I didn't have enough to do, so I decided to form the CEO Association. Jason and the regionals have, there's 12 CEOs of the regional corporations, and they have an association. I'm like, why can't we as the village corporations? There's 200 village corporations. So in 2007, I formed the Alaska Native Village Corporation Association. Used to be CEO Association, we changed it because we want people within the whole corporation to be part of this. And people ask me, why did you do it? And I have these fluffy statements up here that says build a network of support and have stability and sustainability. The real reason, and these guys are, you will be my friend. You'll be my friend. Carl, you will be my friend, because he's got lots of lessons learned. What did you do well? What have you done wrong? Teach me. And so now I can call up any of these guys that I didn't know before 2007, and we can talk about our board of directors. We can talk about financial growth, and we get together once a year with an annual meeting so that we can all get together. I actually have about three or four board members here. Ann, can you stand? And Ron and Nathan. Nathan must be out in the lobby. They are each CEOs of village corporations, and that's what the ANBC board is built with, is you have to be a CEO or chairman of the board for village corporations. Curtis really wants to be on the board, right, Curtis? The other person I'd like to introduce is our new executive director, Kaja Whiteman, if you could stand. I need everybody who needs to know her to go up to her today and talk to her. She is fabulous, and she just took on this role, so I know she's going to do a great job. We're a nonprofit association. We've got 200 village corporations. We don't have all the members yet, but hopefully we will someday. And we get together and we work cooperatively on several issues. Stumbling blocks. This was the initial meeting. And we were actually in Ron's hotel. Thank you for donating that. And the majority of the room were these older Alaska Native men who kept coming up to me and saying, "What the bleep are you doing? You are not my voice. Why are you doing this?" And so I had to explain why we were doing it and moving forward. There was a lot of people who were not for this at all. We voted that day on moving forward. We had 10 members the first year, and that's when I met Willie Hensley. He was in the Captain Cook, and he was in the little, you know, that open restaurant area. He was sitting out there, and we had our 10 to 20 members in our annual meeting, and I asked him, "Can you come speak at our annual meeting?" And he said, "Sure, when?" I said, "Right now," because we were taking a break. And so then he came in and he spoke to the conference. And I won't share with you the other embarrassing story that happened. Okay, so ANVCA now takes on federal and state issues. We're all friends now. You will be my friend, you will. Now we're all friends, and now we're advocating for Native corporation issues with the state government and the federal government. Contaminated lands. Can you believe this? Contaminated lands were given to Native corporations. And the federal government now says, oops, guess who gets to clean it up? Well, we've been advocating this issue in DC because we believe that the federal government is responsible. And so we've taken this report. A copy of it right here. This was actually a report that was given to Congress by the Department of Interior that said there are 650 contaminated lands that were given to Native corporations and they need to be cleaned up. 1998, guess where this went? On the shelf. In the report, there were six recommendations that were supposed to be done within a certain time frame. Establish a forum, get everybody together, create a database, and start prioritizing. Show the ANCSA corporations the policies. Within 30 months, report back to Congress on what you're gonna do about it. Review and revise relevant policies. If their agencies don't have policies on how to do this, get your act together and start doing it. Guess how many of these gotten done? None. Absolutely none. It took one person. One of our members, Brennan Kane, got to give a big shout out to Brennan Kane, who's an ANBC member. He's the Vice President and General Counsel of EAT Corporation. He brought this issue to ANBCA and said, this should be our federal issue this year. This was about 3 years ago. We've been working on this for 3 years. So he brought it to us, we then brought it to the state, and the state, and we went to AFN and the regional corporation. I saw Kim Reitmeier is here. Where's Kim? Kim. Kim's my friend too. You'll be my friend. So we took this to all these different agencies and they all passed resolutions of support. And then of course the state of Alaska said, Yes, the federal government is responsible. So they passed joint House and Senate resolutions, and off we went to lobby in D.C. If you are a student or an intern, I can't tell you, you know that commercial. Are you trying to help me?
Okay. Keep it away.
Yeah. Keep it away from me? Okay. Can you hear me if I'm like this?
Yeah.
Okay.
Better.
I know I have a softer voice. I'll try to be loud. So we then went and advocated in Washington, D.C. We have a whole program on how to do this. I had not been to D.C. I know many of our Native predecessors have. And again, you will be my friend and show me how to do this. Show me how to walk the hill. Show me how to wear my flats and not my high heels when I'm in Washington, D.C. Got my flats on for when you're walking. And we now have a whole program on how do you lobby and advocate an issue when you're in D.C. and or in Juneau. And we brought TDX's, Ron's interns with us, and they have been fabulous. They have been volunteering a lot of their time with us. I also have a lot of individuals like Jared Godfrey, I see, is here. Jared Godfrey, you'll see, he's like our big bodyguard. It'll be all of us ladies in our cuss box, and then Jared's up there bodyguarding us through Washington, D.C. Sarah Lukeen has also donated a lot of her time. And then, I mean, what a valuable experience the interns have also had while they've been going with us to advocate for this. Our Alaska delegation got to get Senator Dan Sullivan up to speed. They know this like the back of their hands. They come meet with ANVC quarterly. And they meet with us in a small room. They're the ones assisting us with this as well. So we know them very well, and they come and they knock on our doors now. And they are helping us with the next steps. Further collaboration. I came 2 years ago to talk to the deans, all of the deans of UAA, and so I'm glad to see that Sherry is taking the lead on moving this issue forward. When I talked to the deans, I said I would love, and can I get a raise of hands of all the deans that are here? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, okay, 6 deans here. What I said to the deans was, wouldn't this be fabulous if you could take an idea like this, and let's start with the marketing department because that's my degree. Wouldn't it be fabulous if we had the journalism marketing department helping us write the white papers on what our issues are? Wouldn't it be fabulous? I've got Red Devil, which is a contaminated mercury mine on my land. Wouldn't it be great if for free I would take two of your students who are in the engineering department or could come to Red Devil and collect samples? Wouldn't it be great if the health department could provide us with statistics on how many people in the region around these contaminated sites have cancer? Wouldn't it be great if the ICER department could then help us collectively provide data regarding this issue? Which department am I missing? Public policy. We'll take you to DC with us, learn hands-on. But wouldn't this be great if the entire UAA system was working collaboratively on an Alaskan issue? To me, it makes sense. I don't know why it's taken 2 years, but I'm the type that let's just go do it. So I would hope that an issue like this, and then if we could do a state issue, take some similar state issue to Juneau, hands-on learning that you could not get anywhere else. Moving forward, we need legislation written, public policy department. Money is a whole nother area, so I won't go there today. Interagency collaboration, just met with BLM and several state agencies yesterday about this and about Red Devil. And then a lot of interagency meetings that are going to need to take place regarding all of the, you saw the map, there are contaminated sites all throughout the state of Alaska. So that's one innovative idea that I'm hoping that each of you will take highly into consideration. I would come and speak to any classroom about this issue and get you started. We came and spoke, I think, in January, and classes had already started, and then we go on with our lives. It happens, life happens. So I'm hoping that we can move forward somehow with this collaborative issue. Okay, I'm gonna pass this bottle around. you would like to take a sip, you can. It's in an orange Gatorade bottle for a reason. This is an innovative idea that was done between the Kuskokwim Corporation and Anchorage Gateway Rotary. My husband was the president of Rotary, and so I had to become a Rotarian. And when I became a Rotarian, we were doing projects, a water project in Gambia. And so I said, why aren't we doing water projects in our own backyard? And so they said, bring us a project. And so I did. I'm now the president. I don't know how that happened, of Rotary. Oops, wrong way. Stony River is one of our villages. There's 56 people in the village, 56 homes, one home. How many of you used the restroom when we took a break? One home. No one's raising their hand. One home has a flush toilet. One home has running water. This is the house that I think are those your nieces? Those two little girls, I think, live in this house. And that house does not have running water or flush toilet. So the project that we came up with in Kalskag. Kalskag actually has the state of Alaska put in a multi-million dollar water system in Kalskag. And they've done that to several villages in Alaska. And they put a lot of effort into it. The unfortunate thing is the state of Alaska did not have funding for maintenance. And so the system has failed. And Upper Kalskag, there's about a population of 210. There's a little store. Let me just do cost of living real fast. Stony River, the little picture of the girls. This isn't poverty. This is below poverty. There are no jobs in rural Alaska. When I talked about Donlin, and we're going to double the amount of subsidiaries, just like Jason talked about, doing companies within our region, that has my heart pumping right now. We negotiated our surface use agreement. We are going to be providing contracts and new companies in the region. We have not been good about hiring shareholders because all those subsidiaries you saw are down in the lower 48, and a lot of our shareholders don't want to move. So excited if Donlin does move forward in 2016. We're working on a training program right now to hire our shareholders, which is why when the university came to me, I said it would be great if you had a program in place for students that I can hire when they're done graduating to run one of these companies and work for their native corporation. That's what I need. I need that in place. I can't do it because my background's not education. We're working on a training program for running the rigs and all the technical pieces with other entities, but really would love to have our shareholders come through the education system here so that I could hire them and they're ready to go.
What's in there?
This is Teresa Morgan, who you see in the blue. This is from her faucet. She is on the water well, the regular state system. She has a toilet and she has a sink, and this came from her sink. She pays $110 to get that water services.
Better off drink of the river.
What I did was I contacted the tribal council and the city council, and they said the city council has a really good water well, really good, and the city was going to sell it to people in Kalskag. Instead, got an agreement made up with the city because half of them are my relatives, and I said, we have to help this. So can we come for free? Here's her drinking bucket. She would take her drinking bucket to the city, fill it up, and she'd scoop it, and that would be her water source. But you saw how elderly she is, and when her nieces or nephews were gone hunting, she wouldn't have water for several days. There's a toilet right next to her. Toilet is her honey bucket because it takes water to flush her toilet, and she doesn't want to use her drinking water. That's the water you see here. So, Anchorage Gateway Rotary. I went to all the other Rotaries in Anchorage and said, we need money, we need to collaborate, we need to do this. We bought this 100-gallon tank, got the city to agree, had my lawyer write it up that forever you'll have to maintain and keep this, and once a week deliver water to the elders. installed these 50-gallon homes in the elders' homes, agreed that the city worker will always go and fill up the tanks, and now Teresa has fresh water. Every time I go out there, her and these three other older ladies come running up to me and hugging me and thanking me, and I can't even tell you how humbling that is. Just an innovative idea and way to solve this problem. Our goal was $50,000. Anchorage Gateway is a small group. There's 20 of us. We donated 5. Lots of in-kind services that you don't even see here from Cusco Crim Corporation. I did a lot of presentations, and we got the money. And last year, thank you. Got the water wells installed. This year, we just delivered on one of the very first barge. We delivered 9 more tanks. And we're going to each of the rodeo groups, and they're so excited about doing a project in rural Alaska. So just another innovative project that we've done that when you think a little differently than putting multi-million-dollar systems in that fail over time. So that's the end of my presentation. Thank you very much.
We have time for just a couple of questions if you would like to take a couple
sure.
of questions. Do we have any students that would like to ask a question of Maver regarding her presentation? Or just
might
in general.
Might need a job someday.
Open it up to anybody else that has a question. All right, you just stunned them.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. So the next presenter, who I kindly refer to as the Godfather of the ANCSA Regional Association, Mr. Carl Mars, joined Old Harbor Native Corporation as Chief Executive Officer August 2010. Carl has been working with Old Harbor Native Corporation since 2005 as an advocate in Juneau and Washington, D.C. on various projects. Carl also had an extensive career at Cook Inlet Region, CIRI, working on various capacities from 1973 through 2004. In December 2004, Mars stepped down as the company's president and CEO. He left behind an organization that in his tenure provided record dividend payouts to shareholders and fulfilled its commitment to enhancing the social welfare of its people. We are pleased to have Carl with us today.
I'm a little bit worried about this Godfather thing. I don't remember sending her a horse head. So. But a little bit different presentation today. One, I'd like to introduce the person that actually put this program together for me and told me I had to stick to it, which is not going to be easy. Cynthia Burns is my Vice President of External Affairs. She's got, you got a clicker?
No.
Oh, I have it?
Do you have it?
Well, that's dangerous.
Here it is. Coming up.
Now, don't stress Cynthia out because she's at 40 weeks right now.
Okay. Okay, one of the things that's important here to remember, I've had a 32-year career at the regional corporation, so it gives me a whole different perspective knowing how regional corporations operate versus what village corporations do and operate. It's substantially different. One is it's like a big family, and you know everybody. Regional corporations, you don't know all your shareholders, and you never will. There's just too many of them. So it's a great experience. The mission statement, there's probably three key words in here and that I pay attention to, and that's create economic development and education. It's to protect the culture. Now, that's sort of at cross purposes sometimes in trying to create economic development while you're trying to protect that culture. So the key to making that work is really having a board that really supports you and trusts you as your management. And it's having a management team that is working together. So it's critical for me with my management, if I have one of the cogs out of the wheel, they can take off and we'll bring somebody in that really wants to be part of the team and really does what the shareholders want in the sense of what the board wants us to do. And part of that's economic growth, but a very big part of it is how do we sustain the Village Corporation of Old Harbor in the village? Because that's where their roots are, but yet people are exiting that village at an alarming rate, like most villages, because there's no economic development. So the idea here is having a management team that can be creative, think outside the box, try new ideas. And I don't mind if somebody makes mistakes, but when they make them, put them on the table so everybody can work on it. Normally, if you have a team of people and there's a mistake made and that individual wants to cure it themselves, it usually gets in worse trouble. But if you have 10 heads thinking about it, you can solve that problem or find a way around it. So it's really simple things, you know, working with a team. And as a CEO, you really are a coach more than anything else. You want to make sure your team is all pulling the wagon the same way or, you know, playing the game the same way. There are things that I've learned over the last 40 years that help that team in a lot of different ways, but you allow them the flexibility. I mean, we pay them good money to do their jobs. You allow them to do their jobs and try not to get in their way, you know. And usually it works pretty well. At least in our case, it's been working well. Old Harbor was had a little dilemma when I started. We had overcommitted to a fiber optic line that was costing the company a fortune. The first thing I did was just cut off those expenditures. Yeah, it caused some problems, maybe some legal problems, but at the same time, it kept the corporation from getting into an illiquid position, which they would have done very quickly. And that process started because, I guess, you know, some people have this grand idea that a little corporation can run out and do $1.5 billion project. Well, that's not really the way it works. You got to sort of take it in baby steps. Am I following the script? Yeah, I know it. One, I probably should put my glasses on so I can see the script. I don't think this is really unique, but I don't know that a lot of village corporations do this. We have a leadership summit every 6 months in the village. We bring the city in, we bring the tribe in, and the corporations there. We talk about the problems in the village. We talk about and put together priorities for the village. I see the role of Old Harbor Corporation supporting those needs of the village, supporting the tribe and their needs, not fighting with the tribes, but how do you work with them? And the tribes normally don't have a lot of money to do a lot of things that they would like to do. So the corporation does put a lot of effort, time, and money into the tribal entity in the city. We've assigned, Cynthia here really covers that area. We pay her, we pay for our office down in Old Harbor. We have two people that work down there, but they also work for the tribe or the city when that's needed. And that's something that we allow the flexibility to do. Again, it's how do you support that village and how do we find ways to build an economic base that will sustain the people in the village and hopefully bring people back. I mean, a lot of people have moved out of that village because there just is no jobs available. So with the leadership summit, a few things happen. One, there's always rumors flying around. So being blunt about things like I am, we just throw those rumors on the table in that group. and try to get to the bottom of what's causing it. Because rumors can be very damaging in a village. Most of you that come from villages know how that works. You know, geez, Henry over there's got this big paying job and he's being favored by the corporation, or, you know, those kind of things. So we try to take those head on so that we don't have those issues. And in Old Harbor's case, it's been very, and I'm pretty proud to be part of that, it's been very successful because everybody has been working together to make this work. There's a lot of projects that we have on the burner that need to be done. Cynthia's sort of headed and directed those in the sense she got the dock, a new dock put in, got this for the city. She had the harbor dredged. We're in the process of building an extension on the runway. And the purpose of that extension is to be able to take fresh fish within that 3A, 3B, or 3C area of fisheries and be able to fly them out fresh fish. The markets are substantially different, that you can pay the fishermen on site much more money on a fresh fish base than you can by putting them on a tender and being controlled by one of the only plant left is the big one. So the fishermen really don't get a good price for their fish. In that process, it's interesting because, you know, part of the policy issues that we're talking about, both state and federal, these are mostly federal rules. As we were going through the permitting for the airport, we had a tidelands permit that had to be done. And we went through that 404 process with the Corps of Engineers. At the end of the process, they told us we had to pay this conservancy group here in Alaska $200,000+, or they wouldn't issue the 404 permit. I mean, it's sort of like being held hostage. You know, you pay this or we're not going to give you your permit. You can't proceed forward. It becomes, for villages, going through this process just becomes so horrendously expensive that most of the villages just drop it. Another place where we had a problem was in the boat harbor. We needed money to redredge or bring the channel down to what it was supposed to be when they first built the harbor. But we were competing for dollars with Anchorage, Seattle, Los Angeles, because they lumped all harbors into one. We were successful 2 years ago in getting that language change, where now they treat small harbors totally separate than you do Los Angeles or Anchorage or those. So we got the funding to be able to get that dredging done. We are in the sort of the same dilemma right now because us with AVEC are working on a hydro project. And it's a 2 mile or mile and a half pipe that runs down and feeds a generator down in the village to provide hydropower. We filed for a permit on that, and it was filed for 575 kW. But the process, the permitting process, is if we were going to build the Hoover Dam. I mean, it's the same process. You can't differentiate. So you really can't afford to go through this process. It's horrendous. So we're working on the same thing for legislation that would allow FERC to look at small projects and treat them like small projects versus these huge hydro projects. The bureaucracy is so large, it's just about impossible to get through. And now the permit that we thought we were going to get, it looks like they've cut it in half because they said we don't need the other generator for right now, so you'd have to come back in the future and go through the same process to get that generator. You know, and you're going, wait a minute, this is crazy. So those kind of issues from a policy standpoint, it's just too expensive for the villages. Maverick talks about the contaminated sites all through Alaska on a lot of lands that are transferred. you know, and the federal government saying it's not our responsibility, you took title to it, so therefore it's your responsibility because you're in the chain of title. But they just ignore it. The federal government can ignore it. They're sovereign and say, yeah, it's not our problem, it's yours. Who can afford to do that, you know? The federal government through the military is the one that screwed up the land. They should fix it, but they ignore it. And they've ignored it for years, and luckily, you know, Matt's been out there pounding on it and maybe getting some headway to get that stuff done. Again, we do a lot of, I'd call work in the village in the sense of supporting programs. Yeah, it can get expensive, but we have a little different, Old Harbor's a little different than most. We don't pay dividends out of the corporation. The board some years ago on the Exxon Valdez was very smart. They took the majority of that money, they put it in a trust. So 2 years ago or 3 years ago, Congress allowed these trusts in perpetuity, a shareholder trust. So we continue to put maybe $1 million or more a year into the trust to build the trust equity. And the trust pays the shareholders. Now, if you think about it, these trusts only pay 10% on their income that they earn. But the shareholder, as long as you've got positive income, the shareholder doesn't pay a dime in taxes on that. It's tax-free. I mean, it's a great piece of work, and it was intended to try to bring us in parallel with tribes in the lower 48, where they don't pay any taxes at all on the members' money as long as they're on the reservation. Well, the settlement was sort of, we'll have to take a 10% hit. But like most of the corporations anymore, you know, our full tax load, we're paying 41 cents on every dollar we make out of the corporation. Yeah, we pay it in, we give it to the trust, and then trust has to pay, you know, this nominal amount on their earnings, which is fine until we run into another gotcha. And the gotcha is we didn't realize this. Somebody wrote in the legislative history this last time around on the Native Trust that if you have negative earnings and you're distributing money to your shareholders, it's a taxable event. Well, that wasn't the intent of the language. So now we've got to go back and try to change that in Congress. So these issues come up all the time. I mean, I think back over 40 years, 45 years now, working with ANCSA, I mean, it's been challenging from the first day. And we think we've got one of the challenges solved. And guess what? We solved that, pops another one because somebody back in D.C. didn't like it. And they changed the language in the legislation, or they changed the legislative history, or the agencies don't like it, so they interpret it differently, and they write policies that cost us money. So those are a lot of the issues that I think every one of you guys have dealt with at some level. I think, and having the village CEOs group, having the regional CEOs group, to focus on these kind of issues is a godsend because then you have a team of people that are working on it. And of course, our congressional delegation is normally very supportive for things that we have. I'm going to the airport expansion. These projects, everybody has their investments in different things, and you know, I'll go through those quickly, but. But the airport expansion, one of the things that we were able to do is we had a, quote, partnership with the state to fund that runway extension. The original cost of that, estimated by DOT, was $48 million, I think it was, something like that, which is ludicrous. So we came up with a plan to be able to do that for about $21 million. What we did is we cut a deal with the state where we would have the funds come to the city. The city would manage the contracts. Instead of going through DOT and them clipping off a big fee, we would do it that way. So it was sort of a unique thing. DOT didn't like it because they weren't getting their fee, but it was operating well until the legislature decided they weren't going to fund it. Well, there goes your partnership. I mean, you're sort of stuck. You're halfway through a project. Now you don't have funding. Yet we had a unique way of doing it that we had, and actually I've got to give Cynthia the credit. She found a way to do this through what we call the Infantry Readiness Training Group, which is a group in D.C. that picks projects that they can train military personnel on. So in this case, the Marine Corps has done most of the work. They come in the summertime. They bring in what they had about 800 people this last year. Anyway, they have every 2 weeks they shift new people through, but it's real training for them because they're operating heavy equipment and actually moving stuff and building something. Their training that they use that they normally get would be in a gravel pit somewhere, grabbing some gravel, moving it from one side to the other. So this is more realistic in the sense of what they're getting trained for. So those are the kind of, you know, sort of innovative thinking outside of the box. And here we thought, damn, we're going to save the state. In fact, by the time we get done, it'd probably be about $17 million. We were able to train shareholders to operate the heavy equipment. Old Harbor, through its scholarship, paid for all that. It saved the money because we didn't have to pay a bunch of people to come in from outside to operate equipment. And we were managing that portion of the building of the runway, so we could put our own people to work. Now we don't have those funding. So all those people lost their jobs. We had to send all that equipment out, sell it off, because we didn't have the funding to complete it. Thank God for the military. They're continuing to go down that path. So again, these aren't easy things to do. They're innovative. And if you have a partner, you usually rely on your partners that when they commit to do something, and in this case, they just decided not to fund it, as hard as we fought for it. But again, you know, shame on us. We should have got all the money up front. That's a lesson we learned. Yeah. Don't trust the legislature. Get your money now. Okay, where are we at? I went so far off your schedule. Kodiak Kenai Cable, interesting thing. Kodiak Kenai Cable was a real project in the sense of how do we get real-time communications to the villages, mainly for health and safety reasons. So we were able to get monies from the federal government to support the rocket launch facility. And the cost of that at the time was about $32 million. So Old Harbor had to come up with about $16 million. We got $22 million $22 million we came up with. I think Old Harbor came up with, at the end of the day, it was around $16 million to fund this project. So the rocket launch facility got capacity. We were able to sell capacity to GCI, AT&T, Alaska Communications, that helped pay for that $16 million part of it. So we got that funded and got it done, but we didn't get to the villages. So the next step was, how do we get to those villages and provide what we said we would provide? And that was building out a microwave system that connected to the primary cable system. So you have real-time capacity in most of the villages today, where we didn't have it before. It was all satellite, be interrupted. We have the health arm. CANA is a big part of being able to provide that service because they have real-time capacity now. I think we don't actually go out and cut the contracts with the providers. We sell them capacity, and then they go out and cut the contracts with a CANA or with the school district or whoever. So that system now is built out to Akiak, Old Harbor, Yuzinki, Port Lines, and we're looking at building one to Larson Bay. Now we had it all mapped out. We knew where we were going. We were working with Fish and Wildlife, and all of a sudden they said, no, that's proposed wilderness area. You can't build there. Well, it's proposed. It's been proposed for 20 years. They haven't got wilderness area there. But yet they want us to spend, I forget it, it's a lot of money, a couple hundred thousand more, to go in and redesign it and move the antennas that are very small footprints so we won't touch their wilderness area. Well, hell, that was all our area before. I mean, but now it's federal government. It's another one of those bureaucratic gotchas because they're afraid, you know, it might affect the bears. Well, hell, the bears will use it for back scratchers, what they do. Anyway, it's just frustrating trying to work through that, especially as a small village. You know, you don't have a lot of resources to do this. Luckily, in our case, we have enough resources that we can take this stuff on, but most of these villages don't. So how do they get economic development into their villages? It's every time you turn around, you got this policy or regulation that stops you. So that's a big part of what the cost is of doing business in Alaska, is this whole regulatory process. I mean, to me, it's crazy to have to spend 18 months, 24 months or so to go through this regulatory process. When we know what we can do, we're not out there trying to harm the land, we're trying to help, and it's a safety, more of a safety health issue than it is worrying about a bear you might, or a bird that you might disrupt, you know, because it's very little impact footprint on those projects. But again, it's the federal government, and I guess, you know, they're a hell of a lot more sovereign than our tribes are, so. With that, we got the ferry system now comes into Old Harbor. That saves us a bundle of money on bringing freight in. Yet it's only proposed once a month, but that's still very helpful. What else we got there? Cape Barnabas. Cape Barnabas is an entity that was backed by Old Harbor that buys up IFQs in the Gulf. The IFQs are used for locals. The village owns them. And they hire the local people to go out and fish them. And that's what the intent was, the IFQ program, is to be able to buy these things in to the villages and let the villages hand them out to their members to go fishing. Well, you know, unlike the CDQ program, where they granted them 10% of the fishery, which was huge for the Western Gulf, or the Western Bering Sea area. In this case, the villages are stuck having to buy these IFQs at a very high price. So, and then just out of the wind comes along NIM, and they cut your allocation in half. Well, you've got a loan from the state that says you've got to pay back these IFQs at a certain price, and you can do that based on the tonnage that you were, or the poundage that you bought, and then all of a sudden they cut it in half. So now these guys are floating along because the price is depressed and their volume's depressed. Had they not cut those in half for the villages' IFQs and spread it across the entire fleet, that would have been about 22 pounds per vessel. But in our case, it took 17,000 pounds out of our allocation. And it really does hurt. So that's another area that, you know, they don't care, North Pacific don't care about what's going to impact the villages. I mean, we're trying like hell to figure out a way to get that allocation back and fight this issue. And that brings me back to the tribes. We've been working on a plan to have the tribes take over the fishery side because they have a government-to-government relationship. The corporations can support those tribes financially for them to do that kind of work, but what's important, subsistence is the number one issue. And, you know, as long as North Pacific's controlling this stuff, you probably won't get much. So commercial fishing is important, especially on Kodiak Island. I mean, that's what it's all about, commercial subsistence and sports. Yet we're losing ground every day. So hopefully the tribes will get it together and, you know, fix this problem. What do we got there? Internship programs. We have a policy that basically if somebody wants to go to school, we'll find a way to get them to school. We'll pay for a big chunk of that. And then we bring them to work. Anybody that wants to work during the summer months, we'll put them to work, either in the village or in the office in Anchorage or wherever else we can find them a job. So we're always providing that piece. We just encourage the hell out of all these kids to go to school. And, you know, we have a major drug problem in Old Harbor. And it's terrible to see, but it's an issue we just can't seem to get the state troopers and those guys to get down there and clean it up. So we're working on a way to with the tribe to try to fix that problem, too. The problem is the state's backing out of more and more of these deals, and so is the borough, the school district, and depending more and more on the village, the tribe, and the corporations to step in. It's not our job to do that. It's the state's and the boroughs and the school district's job to do that. They're proposing a change to these villages, which is devastating because they want to shut down schools if you have less than 50 students. Right now it's 10, and it always has been 10. You do that, it'll kill off a whole lot of villages. You really can't allow that to happen. I mean, we've got to fight for those kind of things. And we also have a scholarship fund. The corporation puts about $50,000 a year in, and we have a big fundraiser every other year. It's a fishing trip. Everybody comes down, has fun, and catches lots of fish. And, you know, we auction off items down there. It's been very successful. What did we do this year? Huh? $57,000 just out of that fundraiser. So it's a great time. So. Oh, Dolly Parton. I got to talk about Dolly Parton. This is the imaginary library issue for kids. It's the Dolly Parton Foundation where they send books off to kids, and it's been very, very successful. So, you know, if you need books for kids, go see Dolly. Am I done?
You're so awesome.
Yeah, right.
Let's give Carl a big hand. Can I take any questions?
But Cynthia will never write a script for me again.
Cynthia, you did great. So are there any questions from students that you have for Carl in his presentation or anything else that... Any questions from anybody else?
I have a little bit.
Yes.
The runway expansion, from how much to how many feet we're expanding?
We're expanding it. The runway now is 2,700 feet. We're expanding it out to 4,700 to 5,000 feet. So you can get a hurricane there, for instance, if you need to.
Yes.
When do you think the runway project will be finished and ready to ship out fish?
If we don't get funding from the state this next year, at least a portion, a couple million of it, so we can continue to blast the rock so the military has something to move. Who knows when it'll get done? And then it becomes very expensive. And, you know, we lose that ability of using the federal, since we couldn't get earmarks anymore, this is sort of an innovative way of getting the federal government to pay for something and be part of it. Again, we just think the state ought to, you know, step up to its commitment. They get the runway back plus more land in the future at more than half the cost it would have cost them if they had done it through DOT.
Let's give Carl a big hand.
Thank you.
So at this time, Rashmi's going to go over what we would like to do is focus the next half hour on talking about policy, and then we're going to have a wrap-up at 4:30. But I just wanted to mention, Clyde's here from NANA, and he was talking at the international, that Bill Pop did last week, International Summit, talking about some of the things that NANA's doing. I know we have the chairman for Sea Alaska here. They have a great program, Ha'ani. There's a lot of examples out there of Alaska Native Corporations doing this good work, and this is just the tip of the iceberg of these presentations. So let's give our presenters a big hand for putting it together. And so now Rashmi will introduce Bill and the process.
Right. So you've heard quite a bit of mention of government, government policy, government regulation. The shadow of the federal government appears to loom very large. In the scene also. So for the next half an hour, we're going to have an interactive session in which we ask you to really pull on your resources and your creativity and your experience and insight to suggest what policy changes can be made to further stimulate and encourage investment and successful projects in rural Alaska. So Bill's going to come up and walk you through the process.
All right, thank you. Great turnout. Great to see everybody here. So hopefully your mind is spinning with the innovative ideas that have been presented. I was reflecting from the beginning. We began with Willie's very sobering comments about the colonialism that Alaska Native people suffered from and the struggle, and in many ways it is a miracle that we're where we are today. Then we've heard a bunch of ideas of how corporations have come through that to generate tremendous success. When you think about it, we all know we're headed into very hard times, and we're going to need to diversify and grow this economy. In many ways, what we now have economically is a colonialism where we're at the effect of policies that are made outside the state, and in many ways the profits are going outside the state. What we're hearing about in stories in this room is that these success stories are first of all fulfilling a purpose larger than simply making money. The money that's made is going into the hands of Alaskan residents. The jobs are being directed at Alaska residents, as are the educational opportunities. So this is the question that's before you, that's on your agenda, which is how can we shift policy to increase the contribution of Alaska Native corporations to our prosperity is a huge and ever-growing important question. Because this is our homegrown economy. I mean, much of the prosperity that we see in Anchorage, somebody talked about the buildings along 36th, those are all local, homegrown, and self-determined efforts. And that's what we really need for Alaska's future. So this is a very vital question we're asking you to contribute to. So the question is, what policy changes are needed to improve the Alaska Native Corporation's ability to stimulate or grow the Alaska economy? What do we mean by policy? Well, Carl talked about regulatory problems. The university is asking for input on educational policy. I'm working with the Department of Commerce, and Jared will talk about this in his closing remarks. The governor's looking for ideas for how the state can invest and alter policy to make this happen. So while you're thinking about the ideas in front of you, we want to capture your ideas for how that can happen. So we're going to ask you to do two things. One, gather by tables. We need about 20 per table. We're going to try to put a student with you to record all the ideas that you come up with. We don't have enough time to go into breakout rooms. So if you kind of cluster together, we'll try to get you. Some of the students have to go take midterms, so we may not have enough. If we don't, we're going to ask you to record your input and give it to Sharon before you leave. The second thing we'd like to ask you is if you're in your discussions, you have thoughts as to how this summit could have been improved, what you'd like to see in next year's summit. We're also interested in hearing those ideas. So we're going to ask you to cluster up for the next 25 minutes. And we'll get a student to your table to record your input into this question. Any questions before we start? All right. Yes. Cluster away. Thank you. So I'm going to bring the microphone around. The microphone is for the video. It isn't live in the room, so we'll just have to listen. And I'm going to ask the student recorders report out one or two of the best ideas that came from your group.
Over here, we came and we talked over there. We came up with some good conversations, but some of the stuff that came to the top was definitely pooling the village and Alaska Native Corporation resources and beginning to work outside your own region and starting to work together across all the regions. And thankfully, we had somebody who comes from the ANCSA boardroom, and she said that's happening. And that's starting, we're going to start working across all the regions to try to help one another get through these difficult times. So that was one of the best, I think, things that came out of that. And then also definitely extending the education tax credit. It's due to be done with in 2017, and trying to expand on that to give corporations the ability to donate to scholarships and donate to education programs like ANSEP, and starting to get credit for that in your taxes and things like that. So those are some of the things that we had talked about. I don't think we'll talk about suggestions now, right? Okay.
You want to give your notes to Sharon?
Sure.
Group two.
Two students.
Okay. It'll be a duet.
So we talked about increasing community development and correlating university with tribes and refocusing on rural development. What else did we cover? We talked about a lot.
we did talk a lot. We had some very interesting points, and there was a lot of issues that between the core, you know, we had a lady with the core, Christy, and I guess, you know, she was talking about how maybe the core could be more involved with some of the rural communities and helping to develop and their issues that they have and work with them and the students. I guess that's about it, but we did have a bunch, we have a bunch of notes.
Did you take individual notes that you could give to Sharon?
Yeah, I'll give them.
Thank you, Cynthia. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, great.
Our group back there, the biggest thing that came out of our discussion was changing the permitting process on projects and maybe suggesting thresholds for different sizes of projects where it's not costing 11 to 15% of the profit on all projects, basing them on large, medium, and small, and possibly the native corporations or the villages creating their own consulting group for regulatory and technical services.
Very good, thank you.
My group was right here in the middle. We had a pretty good discussion about Indian country, which is a hot topic nowadays. A couple things I took down was, we hope we just set up a periodic advisory board. A lot of great ideas are discussed, but a lot of red tape to get things going. It'd be nice to have a place to go for resources. More PDF investing within the state, form Alaska Stainless Development Funds for in-state projects. And then one was change the SBA rules on hub zones. The ANC land shall be considered eligible for pre-designated hub zones. There's a three there.
Very nice, thank you. Thank you. We have one last group here. Oh, okay.
We were a subgroup.
Come on down.
So I worked with a lot of educators, and one of the things that we had talked about is possibly looking at a student's degree plan and then reaching and figuring out what organizations, Native organizations, that they belong to, and have them reach out to the Native organizations to see what programs that they might offer, such as internships, apprenticeships, scholarships, to get them motivated and on the ball.
And then Judy is the director for the Center of Communication, Community Engagement and Learning. She's going to join my Rotary group, and I'm going to join her advisory group, because they both meet on Friday, 12 to 1 and then 2 o'clock, and we're going to get this done. Yep, that's how women do it. Okay.
We know that's how you do it.
That's all this
is. Is that all the groups? Yep. All right, Sherry, bring us home. Thank you, everybody.
So representing the state of Alaska, thank goodness you're there. Jared, he's a Rural and Intergovernmental Affairs Senior Advisor for Governor Bill Walker. Jared is Aleutic with a family lineage from the Kodiak Islands. He grew up throughout rural Alaska and spent his summers commercial fishing in the Kodiak Island fishery. For a combined 14 years, he worked on the North Slope oil fields of Alaska and the Trans-Alaska Pipeline in the Port of Valdez while employed by two different Alaska Native corporations. Jared joined Governor Bill Walker's team this year as his senior advisor on rural business and intergovernmental affairs. He also volunteers his time to UAA's Alaska Native Business Management Program as a mentor and guest speaker. So, Jared, please.
Like somebody said earlier, it's tough following a lot of these elders and Karl Marx, business icon, world-class curmudgeon, Dr. Hensley, Lieutenant Governor Malott, Jason Matrokin. These elders are people I really look up to. And I didn't know he was still here, my bad. I didn't mean that. Notice I didn't say Maver. So I think that this has been a wonderful summit. I think it was a great idea. I appreciate the planning committee. I appreciate the driving force behind this. And they were named earlier. I really appreciate the Dean for taking an interest in this issue. Some things I didn't hear said, and a lot of people may not know it, is approximately the Alaska Native corporations in Alaska represent about 25% of the GDP in the state. That's remarkable. That is remarkable, okay? So they are one of our few net importers of revenue, regardless of where they have their jobs. So we look at all the economic benefit. They are an economic engine unto themselves. They're an institution unto themselves, industries unto themselves. So they go and compete with titans of industry. One ANC may do that. One ANC may be competing with Boeing on technical work and technical manual writing while they're competing with oil field services companies in oil field services, while they're competing with SAIC in IT technologies and government contracting, while they're competing with some marketers in bottling water. One ANC can do that. Now you go find a model of another company. It's very unconventional, it's unorthodox. And I think we talk about ANCSA and the Lands Claim Settlement Act, and sometimes people harp on the things that were less than ideal. And it certainly was not an ideal or perfect, I shouldn't say ideal, it was not a perfect piece of legislation that Congress passed, but then they never have passed a perfect piece. But when you focus on the pluses, you look at the economic engine that these ANCs are, and it's remarkable. And that they have a mandate to care for the social and cultural and economic well-being of their shareholders in perpetuity. They have the resources and some seed money to get started, and so many of them have done that and done that very well. And even with 25% of the GDP in the state responsible for that through their subsidiaries and all their business activities, are we underutilizing them? Are we not leveraging them to their maximum extent? I think a compelling argument, and probably an easy argument to make, is that we're not. And I think that UAA is engaging in this, number one, to help educate and enlighten the academicians that work for them and for the students, and to develop programs that are tailored to that. Not just for people that would want to go and work for a Native corporation, but have the skill set and education to be valuable to the Native corporations, but also to those that want to get into business or industry, maybe not with a Native corporation, but understand what it is to partner with or invest with a Native corporation, to understand that they have a requirement to care for the social well-being of their shareholders and the economic well-being of their shareholders. This is unparalleled in any of the 50 states, but really it's unparalleled in the world. ANCSA was a one-off when it comes to a business model. And earlier you listened to Lieutenant Governor Malott talk about, we had to understand what this corporation thing was about. I'm not an expert on etymology, but corporation starts with CO, like community does, like commune, like cooperate. And the reality is, if you look at a village or a region with a lot of villages of Alaska Natives, They were communities all along. And then this Western capitalistic economic model is thrust upon them and say, go forth and prosper. These Alaska Native corporations are still communities. The shareholders, they're related, and they're friends, and they're family. And those shares are there to pass down to their children and continue the ownership and the pride in that. And that's really different than a publicly traded company. And it's a different, there's a sense of pride, a sense in ownership, and you want to have your employer, if you work for them, do better because the meaning is different than just increasing somebody's investment portfolio in a mutual fund because they have shares of X, Y, or Z. Not that there's anything wrong with that. So the reality is when you think about the tens of thousands of Alaskans that are employed by Alaska Native corporations, the Angster Regional Association pools those numbers from the regional 12 regional corps, but you think about the amount of people they employ outside of Alaska. Because all these Native corporations are headquartered in Alaska, if they have 70,000 people employed around the world, let's say it's a services contract, collectively, let's just look at a service contract, $70 an hour, $40 goes to an individual. The rest goes to that company for every hour worked, for the man hours worked. Where does that money go? It comes right back to Alaska. So it's not just about employing Alaskans because they're net importers of revenue. I have nothing against ConocoPhillips. I have nothing against a number of other companies that do business in Alaska. It's good, I'm glad they do it. But everything beyond their philanthropic contributions, which is great, it's good for the community and the state when they do that, and the payroll that they pay out to Alaskans, all of the profits going out of state. And that's important for us to realize. There is a continued opportunity with Alaska Native corporations. And I think the more that UA seizes on the unique structure and business model and the community ownership of Alaska Native corporations, and they continue to educate the next generation in that, the state will be better for it, Alaska Native corporations will be better for it, and the students that UAA is educating will be better for it. And the university, frankly, will be better for it because they're uniquely addressing something that's uniquely Alaskan and doing so right here on campus. And so I really appreciate this opportunity. I appreciate everybody that turned out. I appreciate the level of engagement. I appreciate the speakers that came and shared their knowledge and wisdom. What Jason and BBNC is doing is remarkable. It's cutting edge. It's innovative. It's out there. You know, I was talking to him during the break. It'd be awesome down the road to see all 12 regional corporations doing the same thing, investing in their region, but having an ownership stake, you know, having a capital position in that. So it's not just giving money away, but this is a good business venture. We'll do it and we'll prop up your idea. I think that's brilliant. And that's a win-win for everyone involved. What Carl Mars and Old Harbor's done, I've watched them do that for a number of years. It's remarkable. It's exceptional. And working with their village and their tribes, that is a model on how to do it. And doing this multi-year, three-tier approach to bring in economic development right there in the form of canneries bidding to come to their town and process seafood. What we've seen TKC do, what they've done from a standpoint of social, the social benefit of the community, clean water, addressing an issue that nobody ever really thinks about, but the reality is, I lived in Bethel for years, I've lived in Northway, I've lived in villages, around the state, and the reality is your quality of life and your health is affected by those things, but we don't think of that often. Who really cares about a job, if you're sick from various illnesses due to the lack of running water or clean water? So there's so much, and these were just three examples, there's so much Alaska Native corporations are doing and continue to do, and the interest is very encouraging, and I think that as we progress in the second, third, and fourth annual, we're going to learn about a lot more out-of-the-box, innovative, cutting-edge business ideas. Thank you, everyone. Any questions? My name tag? Want to know where I got that? Anyone?
Yeah, I have a question. So you kind of made the leap. You've been with Alaska Native corporations, but now you're with the state in the cabinet for the most part. And so one of the things that we wanted to achieve during the summit is to communicate with the state about the importance of education and economic development of our Alaska Native Corporations and the partnerships that need to happen with the state. And because of our fiscal situation, it becomes imperative that we work together and start changing the way we do business in the state of Alaska. And so I just, the question that I have is, you know, there's so many moving pieces right now, and then everybody's wringing their hands, but is there an opportunity to bring these discussions back to the governor and to the legislature in your capacity as rural liaison to spread this message of innovative thinking outside the box and 100 years into the future for Alaska economy?
The answer is yes.
No, I think you go.
Yeah. Thank you, Sherry. Sherry and I do this. I think that the reality is not only is there an avenue to do it, and a medium to do that and bring that message to the legislature and the administration, it's probably, you hit on it, essential time-wise, where we can maximize the benefits that Native corporations, regional and village corporations provide to their communities and their shareholders. It helps Alaska in general, obviously. You know, regional corporations have a mandate to be, you know, for-profit. Village corporations, you know, have a more leeway there as far as nonprofit and for-profit. The state is working right now with tribes to try to allow the tribes to exercise governmental functions by tapping into revenue streams out of BIA, Department of Interior, and that are in DC, that would allow them to exercise what would otherwise be the state's responsibility. And that's easy because we can look at the model and see how they do it in reservations down in the lower 48. I shouldn't say easy, but it's easier. We just cede a certain amount of jurisdiction over certain things and allow the tribes and various communities to stand in the gap there. It's gonna require more creative approaches with Alaska Native corporations, but I'm sure I can hit Jason up and he's got all kinds of ideas on it. There's probably incentives. There's probably various incentives the state could offer. And I think that this is the beginning of a dialogue. And I think this was your vision, it was Sharon's vision, it was Rashmi's vision, that we will move forward and have this conversation and start developing what this is gonna look like down the road. Because someone mentioned earlier, I think Provost Gingrich did, and that being the reality is often there's a gap between academia and theory, it sounds great in classroom, and practice outside in the real world. And sometimes you have people that have great ideas, but how do you implement them, and what are the roadblocks when you're actually operating there? And then you throw in state policymakers, well, that's just schizophrenic, you know? So, but it's doable. And I think that certainly in my capacity, as much as I can, and in interfacing with the AMVCA, and the Village Association, the Regional Association, I'll continue to listen to those ideas. And anybody in the room has ideas on that, bring them to us.
Well, I want to make a comment, if you don't mind. I think the biggest problem is that state government just have no trust into Native corporations at all. For instance, permanent fund. State can easily invest $1 billion in construction of a mall somewhere down Lower 48. But you give $1 billion to Kuskokwim, do you think they cannot dig that gold? Yes, they can. But state don't trust them. And that's the problem. There's no preferential investment policies into local Alaskan businesses.
I think that I appreciate you sharing that, and I'm not going to dispute that. That may very well be the case. I'm not defending the state. I haven't been in the position long enough to be responsible for that. I'm kidding on that part. But the reality is with the state, there are impediments. So when the federal government provides carve-outs or set-asides in the form of the 8A program to Alaska Native corporations, that's withstood judicial challenge. Otherwise, it would be unconstitutional due to the Privileges and Immunity Act, various other clauses in the Constitution, except for the fact that it's treaty and government-to-government concept, even the Alaska Native corporations are not viewed as governments under themselves. It's withstood the constitutional challenges because the federal government has the ability to do it. States, in theory, don't. So they have to be really creative with how do you bid out work? How do you solicit an RFP from a certain group that only fits a certain criteria, as in Alaska Native corporations? One of the conversations that that the governor's been engaged in with the regional corporation, the associations, is they were concerned that they weren't going to get the opportunities to bid on the LNG work that's coming down the line. And all outward evidence is they weren't going to be getting that, because in the commercial sector, the form of what you have in the government sector is pre-qualification. That wasn't taking place. It's equivalent in the commercial sector. And the indications were Exxon and the LNG partnership wasn't going to give any preference to Alaska Native corporations. They had to have a good safety record and be competitive with your price. No value added, no best value contract category, anything like that. That wasn't going to be at play. And no preferential set aside because of your economic and social responsibility to your shareholders. I think that there's a creative way for the state to arrive at that and figure that out. I think there is, without getting sideways with the Constitution. I can tell you whatever they do, it will get challenged. It will be challenged by non-ANC businesses in the state of Alaska. But there are ways to walk that line and thread that needle, and I think it'd be done. I appreciate your comment.
Yeah, if you want something to happen, you will find a thousand ways of doing that. If you don't want that to happen, you'll find a thousand ways of not doing that.
Thank
so
you.
That's,
I just need Thank one.
Yeah.
Well, let's give Jared a big hand. So we just wanted to make some closing comments and thank you all for being here for our first annual summit for Alaska Native Business. And, you know, tomorrow we are going to be at the AFN. The AFN structured their first day of their convention to have breakout sessions or work sessions in the afternoon at 2:30. And so the presenters will be there again, and we'll be bringing some of these policy ideas and discussion into that format to bring it to a larger audience. So you're all invited to come to the AFN and listen in or participate in those discussions. And go and buy some arts and crafts. There's a beautiful arts and crafts booth down there. But
the
I just wanted to.
Location is right there.
The location is right there?
Yeah, on the bottom.
Okay, on the bottom. So, thank you all again for being here and participating, and I'm going to turn it over to Rashmi and to close.
Thanks. And you know, my purpose or my function really is to thank people at this point, but I had just one closing thought, especially since there's a preponderance of university people here right now. I wrote some fine sounding words this morning, but I'm gonna neglect them in favor of a phrase that my daughter sometimes. Use to set me straight, and that is, you know, Dad, you just don't get it. That you don't get it. We referred again and again to gaps of understanding. I mean, so who doesn't get it? When some well-intentioned person working for the federal government in Washington decides that, you know, the equitable way to interpret a policy from their point of view that affects someone in rural Alaska has a devastating impact. You know, they just don't get it. Because they're well-intentioned, but they don't know how remote they are, how removed they are from the ground realities. So we see gaps like that. Where I sit, I was talking with Karl Marx on the sidelines after his talk, and it hit me very hard that we at the university, we don't get it. We don't get it because some of the things our students should be learning, many of the things they should be learning to sensitize them to that environment in rural Alaska, the kinds of challenges that Carl, for instance, is contending with, the challenges that Maver is contending with, actually all of rural Alaska is, and she reminded us, didn't let us off the hook, that she came here and talked to, it was more than just deans, Maver. It wasn't just the deans, but they were there. Some of the deans have changed. So, but you know, does our curriculum, are we teaching our students what they need to know to really understand the place they live in? And what are the consequences of them not knowing? See, at one level, we might be comfortable and say that, well, in fact, it would be nice to know, but it would be nice to know anything and everything, including the, you know, the surface topography of Pluto, which we know now, too. So, only by learning, for instance, can we start to understand some of the creative solutions for that 100-year journey that Sherry originally asked me about? You know, only then can we understand that, in fact, if we use the resources of the state, the financial resources of the state, if we can, you know, utilize financial instruments in a much more creative way than we have. I mean, bonding, for instance, in rural Alaska, only when we come to understand, only, for instance, when a business student comes to understand the realities of rural Alaska and the needs, can they use their business acumen to imagine or envision solutions. So it is, I'm leaving this summit with a certain sense with a troubling feeling that we need to do very much more on the educational side to fill in those gaps so that we do get it. And we'll have to keep working and keep doing this kind of thing year in and year out so that all the parties do get it, so that well-intentioned people don't do damage unintentionally, put it that way. Now for the thank you. So thank you all for, especially those of you sitting here right now, the veterans, the true believers, the 4-hour people with a lot of endurance. So thank you, of course, to the Chancellor and Provost Gingrich for supporting this throughout. Thank you to Sherry Beretta, really, who was the energy behind this concept and really the moving force behind it. Thanks to all of the folks at the College of Business and Public Policy, starting with Sharon Lind, for all their efforts. And thank you to all of you for being here. I'd like to thank the Alaska Native Studies Group for providing a copy of this book. I mean, this helps many of us in starting to get it, to understand it. Also, Alaska Business Monthly for providing a copy of their monthly. And Sharon, you said you'd set me straight if I neglected to thank anyone else. Okay. Sharon?
Well, just in regards to this conference, you could tell your daughter you got it.
So, yeah.
Thank you.
Certainly my personal education. This has all been my personal education, and I accept it very, very humbly. So thank you. And thanks for coming. Have a good day.